to this dedication of the district court being named for Judge J.D. Allen, and I know that he had many friends. I can see that in the audience today. Before we begin, I would like us to do the pledge, and then I'm going to turn it over to Brother Jerry Bryan to do the invocation.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
My name is Jerry Bryan. I'm the pastor of Emmanuel United Methodist Church. And I was J.D. Allen's pastor. And he was my pastor. Let us pray. Almighty God, we come here to this wonderful historical place to praise a son of yours, and known far and wide as a just and fair and merciful man, J.D. Allen. We've gathered here, as we've gathered here, may we use our best skills and judgment and our remembrances of this good and wise man who walked among us until only a short time past. Help us to be mindful of keeping ourselves impartial in life and neutral as we consider the merits and the pitfalls of each matter that is placed before us in our daily lives, as did Judge J.D. Allen, as he lived his life in this community and state and nation. We remember J.B. as a man of wise counsel. By his knowledge and his wise and eloquent instruction for our lives and community, he was a merciful man whose righteousness has not been forgotten but is still longed for by we who were and still are blessed by his dealings with us. May we who remain continue to receive from his inheritance left for us remain within the covenant that he so diligently taught us by his life. We gather here intent on doing good work, fairly and well, as he taught us by his presence among us. As he did, may our efforts be blessed with insight, guided by understanding and wisdom. May we, as he seek to serve to respect and respect all, may our personal faith give us strength to act honestly and well in all matters that come before us, as did J.D. Allen. May we use our resources wisely and well to represent all members of our community fairly, to make decisions that promote the common good, and help us, as J.B. recognized, our responsibility to the past and the future, and the rights and the needs of both individuals and the community. As trusted servants, may we, as J.B. Allen did, seek blessings for our deliberations and for our efforts always. We know, Almighty Father, that as we live side by side, we share our community, and we take each other for granted living our lives, going through our days, seldom thinking of community, seldom stopping to think of the needs of our neighbors, caught like us in living and providing for ourselves and family. Community is just there, and we take it for granted until some disaster or hardship comes and or weather rages. Then we suddenly and desperately need our community. We need it to help us survive, keep hope alive, to live. J.B. was such a citizen. Looking beyond himself, it's men like J.B. Allen who helped provide the essential safety net in us all. J.B. was our neighbor, and he loved his community. He served it well and faithfully his whole life. We are blessed by having had him in our lives. May we have more men and women like him come into our lives in the years ahead. In the name of and through our Heavenly Father's power, we pray. Amen. I would like to introduce another Allen, James Brad. That's Brad. He's also in my church. I just want to get that in.
You know, those Methodist preachers, they're all big fans, and I don't know. I'm surprised we didn't change some of the denominations. On behalf of Jeff and myself and our entire family, I want to thank everyone for attending this fantastic day. I'm a little bit on the nervous side. I'm honored. I want to thank the county commissioners. I want to thank our county manager, Brian Haygood. I want to thank Michelle Mills, who has put this all together and worked great and tireless hours and did a great job. I want to thank Chief Justice Mark Martin for attending, and of course, Judge Wayne Abernathy, who made this nomination to the county commissioners. What an honor. What a legacy, what a man. What a mentor, friend, colleague, advisor, wise, thoughtful, motivator. Attorney Jim Walker, I talked to him the other night, and he said, a great judge, but a better man. How fitting. Who would have thought that someone who was born and raised on Kilby Street, lived in four houses that his grandfather built one, his dad built two, his uncle built the other one. They were all carpenters, the backyards were all connected, and he stayed in that same neighborhood within 50 yards of each other his entire life. That he had two parents, one who completed the sixth grade, one the eighth grade. A humble man. He never forgot his roots. He loved Burlington, Alamance County, North Carolina. He loved his family. He loved his church. He loved the work, and he loved the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. He was the only child, and y'all know about only children. My wife's one. And he was spoiled rotten by his grandmother. But she was spoiled him with love. Every Sunday after church, we had a feast at her house. And because he liked homemade pintos, we had homemade pintos out of the bag, picking the rocks out and cooked every Sunday. She was also very loyal to him. And I'm not sure if I saw Tom Boney, if he's here, or someone with Alamance News, but his dad, Tom Boney Sr., would occasionally write something that Grandma didn't agree with. She had a subscription to the Alamance News for as long as I could remember, except for when they said something ugly in her mind about her baby. And she would call and cancel, cool down a few weeks later, they'd call her back and she'd start it back. I know all you lawyers that are here and everyone else knows about JB time. Well, his dad, Grandpa Jeff, had Jack time. If it wasn't for him, he probably wouldn't have went to college because Grandpa Jeff worked him like you wouldn't believe. He worked him in construction, so my dad went to night school while working at Western Electric. And he loved Alamance County. They wanted to promote him and move to Whippet in New Jersey, but he was not moving. He stayed and changed professions to become a probation officer. Judge Henry McKinnon saw the potential, wrote a letter before he even told him that he should apply for law school. He was a simple man, but very complex. He saw the big picture, and he had common sense. Jeff and I and all the neighborhood kids, including Nelson Dollar, who's here, who's very successful in the legislature, it was like growing up with Sheriff Taylor on the Ann River. And the combination of John Wayne and throw in a little Vince Lombardi. He gave his time to the neighborhood, to the kids. He would organize our backyard football games. He would teach us rules, sportsmanship, fair play, coaching, SABC, and stayed on the board for a number of years, and he's influenced so many people that he and I do not even know about. Don't forget, though, he was very competitive. He never let Jeff or I win at anything. If we beat him, we earned it. If I got one B and all A's, he said, why didn't you get all A's? He would keep you close, Jeff was reminding me, because he didn't want to tear you down, your self-esteem. And we would play tennis at the Moose Lodge. Before we could go swimming, we had to play tennis because Mom wanted to play tennis. And usually it was Jeff and I in our early teens playing Mom and Dad. It was close until we got ahead, and then he was in his mid-30s, and he would run all over the court, and still we were playing 2-1. He wouldn't let Mom even hit a shot. She would get so mad. He always did what was right, whether it was popular or politically correct. I remember one time I used to would be sent in to go order Zach's hot dogs. We were at the old Zach's. And I was a little boy, barely could see over the counter or through the window. And some guy came up and nudged right in front of him. I've seen that face when I really didn't want to see that face as he come bounding across the street, and his face was purple. Not red, purple. And some of y'all lawyers that's heard him in court before, and his not so subtle voice as he walked in, he said, "Did that guy jump in front of you?" As he was whispering. At that moment, the guy behind the counter said, "You're next." And he said, "No, this little boy right here is next." He taught me you stand up for what's right and wrong. When the Sheriff's Department in Burlington PD were having some difficulties, he formed what is still the Alamance County Executive Law Enforcement Committee. This today is still in force. He formed it back in the 70s. When there was problems with race relations, he and Julia Jordan, who was a community leader, he and her got together and formed a community relations that has changed numerous times, but it was the root and starting that. He had a good heart. He told me one time there was a kid. His parents were sorry. And that was his words. Juvenile court ordered to send him to training school. He didn't. He gave the boy $20 and sent him to live with his grandma. What a legacy. He would read the advance sheets. I can remember like it was yesterday, laying on the couch, but he would never turn us down when we asked him to come out and play in the backyard. He was competitive, he worked hard, and all due respect, Chief Justice, when some of your colleagues on the Court of Appeals, on the few times that they did, find him to be wrong, in his opinion, they were wrong. John Zanthus, who there's a statue down the street. My dad told me John Zanthus, and they put that up after he passed away. He said John Zanthus would not have wanted that. John Zanthus also told me when I was a young prosecutor, he said, "Your dad would be an excellent Chief Justice or Justice on the Court of Appeals, Supreme Court." He would, I thought, have been an easy and a great pick for a governor. The problem is, I don't think they would have put the mansion on Kilby Street in Burlington. He would have not wanted this name of this courtroom named after him. That's probably why we have the weather like it is. He's probably mad at you, Wayne, but Grandma Louise, you're invited to her house all the time. All y'all attorneys over the years, and I'm sure you'd love to have said this, Judge Allen, your objection to name the courthouse after you is overruled. Thank you.
How do you follow that? I don't know. Let me just say this. Judge Allen was involved in the criminal justice system for many, many years. As a probation officer, as an attorney, assistant district attorney, district court judge, and superior court judge. And folks, I'm here to tell you,
I have been in law enforcement 46 years. I have never heard a person say a bad word about Judge J.B. Allen Jr. Most of all, he was a good father and a good leader in the community. I remember as a young SBI agent playing softball, and Judge Allen was a coach, and y'all were about that high. Just braid it out. And we had a good time, I'm telling you. He was a teacher of young law enforcement. You learn more from that seat right there in his courtroom when you were trying a case, what you done right, what you done wrong. He taught young officers the law the way it was. He was a man among men. He never looked down his nose at anybody. He was successful in everything that he done because he had his life with God. A true patriot and a God-loving man. That was J.B. Allen. A man of honesty, a man of compassion, a man of integrity, a man of patience. I know no one in this county history that's more deserving to have the court's building named after them than Judge Jasper B. Allen Jr. And I feel the name. To any young officer that is in this courtroom, he set the standards for the Alamance County court system. J.B. Allen set the standards that we live by today. And I have, as an agent with the SBI, I appeared in court in many counties in this state. And no courtroom was run like J.B. Allen Jr.'s courtroom was run. I'll assure you that. You could hear a pin drop in his courtroom because he believed in our system of justice. He believed in everything. He believed in people. He was compassionate with defendants unless you lied from that stand or you attacked a law enforcement officer. And then you better have brought your toothbrush with you because you were going to jail. And I've seen it many times. But folks, we should never, ever let his legacy go untold to our young officers, to our children in this county. Because his picture is right there. He was a judge of judges, in my opinion. He was a man that I admired and still admired because I was a young officer sitting in that seat many days in this courtroom. He was a good man. He was a father. A father of Jeff and father of Brad. But more than that, he was a father of every one of us that grew up here in Alamance County. He did not see color. He was not prejudiced. He loved people. But he also knew what his job was when he put that robe on and took that bench. And any of you that's never been much in a courtroom, there's a lot of decisions that has to be made on that bench that you have to weigh a lot of circumstances. And believe me, it's not easy when you look a person in the eyes and have to sentence them to 20, 25 years in prison. Or even life in prison. But he did his job because he knew what his job was. And he cared about the people in this county. And today is the greatest day for Alamance County, as far as I'm concerned, because we are naming the court building after Jasper D. Allen Jr. And folks, I want to say this. Let's not ever let his legacy go untold in this county. And may his soul rest in peace. God bless you. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Wayne Abernathy, the recently retired senior superior resident court judge from Alamance County. I suspect you would have the same problem that I'm having in trying to capture the significance and the impact Judge Adam had on the courts of Alamance and North Carolina with a few words. I can't do it. But I'm going to try because you don't want to listen to me for a long time. But when I was elected to succeed J.D., I traveled in the 3rd Judicial Division. For those of you who don't come to court, the state's divided into divisions, and Superior Court judges ride a circuit, and we go 6 months of this county, 6 months of the next county. And our division extends from Alamance to Raleigh, up to Warrenton, and back down to Chasm. Seems like everywhere I went, when I first arrived, everybody had a J.D. Adams certificate. They were always interesting. A lot of them were funny, but you could tell in all the 11 counties of the 3rd Division, he was well-liked and certainly well-respected. Now, I was not going to tell this story, but I've got to tell my personal J.D. story. Sometimes you just can't shut an old judge up. When I had been practicing law for months, not years, but months, way behind the ears, knew next to nothing, I had to appear in Superior Court and District Court at the same time on the same day. Now, the rule is you go to the higher court first, unless you're in a trial in the lower court that's already started. Well, at that time, Judge Allen was the district court judge, and I was trying a civil case in front of him, and I was already nervous. So I ran up to this courtroom, left a note up there on the bench for the Superior Court judge that says, "Dear Judge so-and-so, I am trying the case in Judge Allen's court in district court that started yesterday. I will be here as soon as we finish." Well, so I'm down there in front of Judge Allen, and the bailiff comes to the door. Remember those little glass window panes in the downstairs courtroom? It's what have I done wrong? So Judge Allen, the bailiff's there. Could I have just a moment? Sir, I go out there, and the bailiff says, "The judge wants you in Superior Court right now." And it was only like a 10-minute thing I had to do up here. I said, but I can't go. I'm in front of Judge Allen. Well, I'll go tell him that. About 30 minutes later, Judge Allen, I go out there, same thing, tell him the same thing. This happens about 3 times. We finish the case. The district court's 1 block from here down Elm Street. I literally ran. In those days, I couldn't run. I literally ran that block and came up the back steps, and the judge was sitting in the chambers back there. And I went flying by the door, and out of the corner of my eye, I saw him. And of course, I, you know, breathing. And I go back, and I'm trying to apologize. And he looks at me and he says, "If you ever do not come to my court and go to that court, I'm going to put your blankety blank in jail." The second blank referred to a portion of my body. And I'm sitting there thinking, I went to law school for 3 years for this. I'm truly crazy. I couldn't go to the textbooks. You know? And so we came in, we did the little 10-minute plea, and I didn't know anybody that well. So this week I happened to see Judge Allen in his office, and I thought, I'm just going to touch base with him. And I went in there and I told him what happened, and he got real stern. Now, any lawyer knows that Judge Allen can be stern. And he could freeze water. He looked at me and he said, "Wayne, if you ever leave my court and go to that man's court, I'm going to put your blankety blank in jail." And at this point, there wasn't much left of my blankety blank. And he's looking at me, and then he starts smiling this big grin. He says, Don't worry about it. You did exactly the right thing. But he was an amazing person. And everywhere I went, I heard stories, not quite like that, but I heard stories about Judge Allen that just demonstrated how well thought of he was in the third division, as well as around the state. And he was handpicked to try a number of very difficult cases. He tried some tough murder cases in his life because he was also well thought of by the appellate courts and the administrative office of the courts. The other thing that I think the people who weren't in the system don't realize is how instrumental he was in giving advice to young lawyers in Alamance County and often to judges. When I first went on the bench, I mean, he had 38 years of experience as a judge in both district court and superior court. You just don't replace that, especially not with me. And so when I went on the bench, I had that telephone number of his, and I didn't mind calling him, and he didn't mind taking my calls, providing sound advice, and I was able to take advantage of his wisdom. And he was also one of the hardest working people I've ever seen. When he reached mandatory retirement age, we had to convert our conference room to an office in JB because you couldn't get him out of the courthouse. And he got there, but the rest of us did. He was just a hard-working man, and I think he illustrated that in most jobs, including the judges' jobs, it's about 90% hard work and 10% brilliance, you know? Or maybe not even 10%. But he was, as Sheriff Johnson said, he was a judge's judge, he was the lawyer's lawyer, and he was well respected. I also want to thank the Board of County Commission, who's many of you here today, for agreeing at my request to name the criminal courts building after Judge Allen. He was instrumental in getting the building built. He was instrumental in convincing others of the need for the building, and frankly, we just couldn't exist today without it. Truthfully, it's probably not big enough, but that's another thing. He was just very instrumental in seeing that the best things were done for the Alamance County Court System. And I'm very grateful to the County Commissioners. It was unanimous vote. There was almost no discussion. It sailed through. And I appreciate them recognizing that it was the right thing to do. The other brief statement I'll make is that some of you may be aware that Judge Allen was a man of strong opinions. Speaking of purple, when I was in front of him, my guy and I would not be talking until the pain in the back of his neck started to drop, because that's when I sit down and be quiet no matter where I was. But he could get a little purple at times. But he did have strong opinions. And one of the things I think Judge Allen would say, if he were here today, that he would ask you, well, he'd probably tell you, but he would talk about that our system of government for over 200 years has served us well with three branches of government, the executive or governor, the legislative, and the judiciary. And he would talk about how important it is for the judiciary to remain independent and not subservient to anyone but the Constitution and the people of the state. And he would ask you to do what you can to help maintain the independence of the judiciary, because the judiciary should not be beholden to anyone. They should be above the affray. Today, it is my privilege to introduce to you the Honorable Mark D. Martin, the Chief Justice of the North Carolina Supreme Court. Chief Justice Martin has served our state as a Superior Court judge, and then in 1994 he was elected to the Superior Court, to the Court of Appeals. After 4 years, that's 94, then in 1998 he was elected to the Supreme Court of North Carolina as the youngest justice ever to serve in that position in the history of our state. Justice Martin graduated with highest honors from Western Carolina University. He then graduated from the University of North Carolina School of Law with honors, and he received a Master's of Law from the University of Virginia. He has served on the faculty as an adjunct professor at the Schools of Law at Chapel Hill, NC Central, and Duke. He has served our state for many, many years, and he currently serves on the Committee on Federal and State Jurisdiction at the Judicial Conference of the United States. He is chairman of the National Chief Justice's Professionalism and Competence of the Bar Committee. He is also the chair of the North Carolina Legal Access to Justice Committee, which works to ensure that all people of this state have equal access to the courts of our state. He serves on many other state and national committees whose purpose is to promote justice and to advance the rule of law. He also has the unenviable task of overseeing our state's court system, which faces ever-increasing demands due to our growing population, increased crime, continued increase in drug abuse and opioid addiction, and other problems. And he does this despite a decreasing share of the state budget. As co-chair of the National Summit on Fair and Impartial State Courts, he, with representatives from 38 other jurisdictions, worked to find sustainable and adequate funding for our court systems throughout the county. Despite the demands on his time that many of these and his other committee responsibilities have, as well as his job as the Chief Justice, it speaks volumes that Chief Justice Martin has chosen to come to Alamance County today to honor us on behalf of Judge Allen. Ladies and gentlemen, I ask you to please stand with me and welcome Chief Justice Mark B. Martin. Thank you.
Good afternoon. It's my great honor and privilege to be here at the dedication of the Judge J.D. Allen Jr. Courthouse. Now, I think all of us know that probably my speech is unnecessary today. You are so blessed to have the leaders that you have here in Alamance County. You heard from a pastor, you heard from a county commissioner, you heard from your sheriff, you've heard from the Superior Court judge, and you've heard from Chief Judge Brad Allen of the District Court. And I know each of you have been moved as I have by those remarks. And at the outset, I want to say that, and Brad, I'm not sure, to be honest about it, 23 years on the appellate courts, so I don't know if I ever reversed your father or not. But if I did, I was probably wrong. Now, we are all here today to honor Judge Allen for his distinguished career in the judicial branch and to name the criminal courts building in his honor. Courthouses are the most physical embodiment of the rule of law, and what a privilege it is to live in a society that is governed by the rule of law and not the rule of men. So what does the rule of law mean? It means that there are a just set of laws and that those laws are applied fairly and uniformly to all. It says a lot about who Judge Allen was. Really an embodiment of that rule. But the rule of law doesn't just happen. When people come into power, there's always a risk that they will abuse that power, giving special privileges to people when they think it will benefit them at the expense of others. And these abuses are what the rule of law was meant to guard against. And I do not know a more effective guardian of the rule of law than my friend Judge Allen while he was here among us and during his service on the course. But make no mistake about it, promoting the rule of law and preserving it is the task and the responsibility of each and every one of us. Courts do this by using time-tested procedures and methods to resolve disputes, by observing constitutional and statutory safeguards that the American people have devised in our Constitution and in our laws, and by being neutral and independent of the parties that appear before courts, as well as the other two branches of government. This core function of upholding the rule of law is reflected in the mission of the North Carolina Judicial Branch, to protect and preserve the rights and liberties of all the people, as guaranteed by the Constitution and laws of the United States and North Carolina, by providing a fair, independent, and accessible forum for the just, timely, and economical resolution of disputes. That says a lot about Judge Allen writing that mission statement, because that reflects the life he lived and the service he unselfishly gave for all those years. United States Supreme Court Justice Sam Alito has said that the only obligation of the judge, and it's a solemn obligation, is to the rule of law. Judges perform the sacred constitutional duty of preserving the rule of law by always doing justice on behalf of the citizens that they serve. Their role is unique in our democracy. It's the charge of judges to secure the rights and liberties guaranteed under law for the people of our state, and to preserve those rights and liberties for future generations to come. For that reason, judicial leadership requires integrity, diligence, compassion, and courage. It is certainly worth honoring and celebrating when someone has exhibited these qualities in his daily work, like Judge J.B. Allen Jr. did. We just celebrated the 50th anniversary of the district courts of our state last year, and are celebrating the 240th anniversary of the Superior Courts this year. Judge Allen served on both of these courts, and it's fitting that we're naming the Alamance County Criminal Courts building in his honor during this period of celebration. He gives us a chance to honor his example of the qualities that a judge should exhibit during his time, and as he in fact demonstrated during his service on both courts. I know on personal experience, and having worked with Judge Allen, that he was a well-respected, faithful public servant to Alamance County and to our state, and he was a pillar of the legal community. When I joined the Conference of Superior Court Judges in 1992, there was not anyone who was kinder to me, who helped me along, and became a mentor for me as I became a Superior Court judge. Outside of the courtroom, Judge Allen was dedicated to his family and to his community. He was married to the late Judy Barnhart Allen for 44 years, and they had two sons. I think it says a lot that both of Judge Allen's sons have followed in his footsteps. Jeffrey as a probation officer and Brad as a judge. It was my distinct privilege to appoint Brad Allen to be Alamance County's Chief District Court Judge in 2014. And I am getting choked up a bit, because at the time I did that, I was thinking about his father. And Judge Brad Allen had served in such an exemplary way that I couldn't help also thinking about JB at that time, and how proud JB would have been and was. Judge Allen dedicated over 40 years of his life to public service right here in Alamance County, and 38 as a judge. And I'm celebrating my 25th anniversary as a judge this year, so I still have a ways to go, Brad, to catch up with your dad. One thing I always remember about Judge Allen is his remarkable work ethic. He understood the weight of the responsibility of being a judge, and he took that responsibility seriously. That often meant getting to the courthouse earlier than others and staying later than others. But his preparation garnered respect from attorneys and his fellow judges, and obviously resulted in many years of fair and impartial decisions on his behalf. Judge Allen showed an incredible amount of professionalism throughout his career. There are many that are concerned about the trend in our society among politicians, even among judges and lawyers, about professionalism. What a model Judge Allen was to all of us. And many of you will recall that he regretted having to retire in 2010 because he sincerely felt, and we agree, that his legal knowledge and experience were such at their greatest point, and how that was so beneficial to younger attorneys and to younger judges. As I said, he was a true guardian of the rule of law. He judged fairly based on the evidence presented to him. He held everyone, including himself, to the highest standards. His legal skill and ability to judge fairly gained him the respect of all of his colleagues and of all those who appeared before him. He was a role model to so many in the profession, including me. When I think about Judge Allen, we ought to have a segment in the new judges course that talks about his life, because I think the more our new judges could emulate Judge Allen, the better judges they would be for our people. He was a true gentleman and a man of honor. When I talked to former Chief Justice Burley Mitchell, we both agreed. Judge Allen was a legal scholar. He was a very bright man. But he had that unique ability, whoever he talked with, to simplify the matter and to make sure that everybody understood the legal issues that were involved. He was humble and he was approachable. I so admired and respected Judge Allen, as did each and every member of the Conference of Superior Court Judges. And I will say that Alamance County was certainly fortunate to have such an able, principled, and dedicated judge on the bench for almost 40 years. Former Chief Justice Mitchell once said, "We who hold public offices must remember that the people entrust them to us, and that we should return them to the public in better shape than when we took them." I know that Chief Justice Mitchell and countless others would agree when I say that Judge Allen exemplified this sentiment throughout his decades of faithful service to our judicial system. In fact, his positive impact on the judicial system extends beyond his contributions to the jurisprudence of the state. When this historic courthouse was in desperate need of repair and expansion in the early 1990s, Judge Allen was instrumental in the completion of the criminal courts building. He was dedicated both to ensuring that he had the knowledge and preparation needed to uphold the rule of law, and that the courts had the physical space needed to administer justice for all. There was a giant who was among us for a while. His name was Judge J.B. Allen Jr. Now, I will tell each of you, he is now looking down to see that we do our role to make sure that our government does everything it should do, that our courts continue to hold the high standards that he held himself to and to others, and that we continue to have judges that have the same ethics and integrity of Judge J.B. Allen. I can think of no better name for the Alamance County Criminal Courts Building to bear than the name of my friend, Judge J.B. Allen Jr. Thank you very much.
Folks, I don't know how I could add anything to what's been said today that, tells the story of J.B. Allen Jr. Brad, I just want to thank you and Jeff for even being considerate enough to invite me to come speak at this momentous occasion today. Judge Allen has made such a difference in Alamance County, and every time you ride by the courthouse now, these words that have been spoken by our Chief Justice and others, remember what that name represented. He was a great pillar in our community for many years. He worked, advocated for justice here, and he personally inducted me the first time I was elected commissioner. He said, "Are you sure you know what you're doing?" I said, "Well, I'm not sure. We're going to try this." I always had a little humor when you talked to him, too, which was good. Thanks to everyone for coming out. And I think Brad said something about
reception.
There will be a reception downstairs, and we'd like to welcome everyone to come through and enjoy that. Thank you very much.